fungus gnats.
Grow room rat, orange.
Small, pesty flies, 2 or 3 millimeters long like mini mosquitoes, but they don't bite or sting, no. Instead, they love to crawl and creep around on plants and growing media. They fly around stupidly, getting in your face, buzzing from place to place slowly and seemingly without purpose, but somehow very irritating at the same time, kind of like my follower-in-law on Facebook. Some growers confuse them with winged root aphids, which are better flyers with a rounder, broader body, and are more attracted to your grow lights. Sure, the adult gnats themselves don't do any damage, but they love to fly into my eyes and up my frickin' nose and seem to have a sixth sense of when I have both my hands full and I can't swat at them, but okay, it's their larvae hatched from tiny eggs laid by the female adults in moist growing media that cause all the issues, especially to young plants. The fungus gnat larvae primarily feed on organic material, algae, and soil fungus, but in increasing numbers, that necessitates a broader diet, including roots and plant stem tissue. Yes, they nibble on your plant's roots, people. This, in turn, creates wounds, which open up the gateway to secondary infections from the likes of Pythium, Phytophthora, and Fusarium. Seedlings and younger plants can die. Older plants can stop growing. Leaves will discolor and wilt, and nutrient and water uptake will slow. It's enough talking already. Let's go neutralize some gnats. As with all pests, you must first understand their life cycle and disrupt it, preferably at multiple stages at once. Ignored, fungus gnats will breed uncontrollably, and a few weeks after spotting a handful of gnats, you'll have a major infestation on your hands. Fungus gnats can hitch a ride into your grow room on your clothes or cuttings accepted from friends, through gaps between doors and walls, and soil, compost, and soilless potting mixes. Once introduced, they seek out moisture and humidity. Top feeding your plants too often creates ideal breeding conditions, that is, moist surface growing media. Consider irrigating your pots from below and allowing your plants to wick up moisture instead. At the very least, ease off with the irrigations and let your growing media dry out more between waterings. Now, adult fungus gnats enjoy a brief moment of sexy time together, and then the females lay their eggs in your growing media, sometimes also in the algae that forms at the top of stone wool blocks. Try using block covers or fashion some yourself with little squares of Corex or plastic sheeting to stop the algae from forming in the first place and to form a physical barrier against the gnats. Okay, now that we know our enemy better, how do we kill them? I recommend a two-pronged approach, my friends. Target adults with foliar sprays and traps and larvae with nematodes, mites, or biological larvicides. Now, you should always have some yellow sticky traps in your store cupboard. Even better, already in your garden. Sticky yellow traps are a handy monitor for pests, not just a reactive measure. Peel the protective wrapper from both sides and lay them on the tops of your pots like this, rather than hanging in the air, so they catch emerging adults. Next, call your local grow store and ask them if they have any predatory insects in stock. Do this right now, because chances are they may have to order them, which can take a few days. For the adults, try something like Asmax, a botanical insecticide, miticide, and nematicide. Use a foliar spray for a few days before sending in any beneficial insects. Make up a medium-strength solution, 1 fluid ounce per gallon, and foliar apply immediately. Work fast, wear a respirator mask, and get the hell out of there. Just like the zombie apocalypse, my friends. As for killing the babies, if you have cuttings or seedlings and blocks, you can dip them into a bacterial larvicide containing Bacillus thuringiensis, israelensis, or BTI, such as Gnatrol WDG or mosquito dunks. Sorry, got a little carried away. Remember, if using multiple combat methods, it's important to know that they're fully compatible with one another, as some pesticide products will kill your predators. Also, ask your grow store for advice on specific product combinations. Parasitizing nematodes are incredibly effective against fungus gnat larvae and can decimate fungus gnat numbers in days while causing no harm whatsoever to your plants. The nematode species of choice for this application is Steinonema feltiae. You can buy them in little packets. It looks like dust, but lurking within are millions of tiny little beneficial nematodes. Note the use-by date on the packet. The nematode enters the body openings in many types of soil larvae and uses them to breed, killing the larvae in the process. Excellent. Fill a watering can with dechlorinated water and then add the nematodes and stir. Apply carefully and evenly to the surface of your growing media. I redirect the drain pipe of my ebb and flow table to catch the runoff so I can reapply to other plants. They won't survive long sat in water, so use it up right away. Hypoaspis miles is a tiny predatory mite invisible to the naked eye. Has recently been reclassified with an even catchier name, Stratolalapsimidis. Many growers deploy these mites as a preventative measure, as they can last up to 70 days without food, so why not just let them hang out just in case? Usually they come prepackaged in sachets or tubes of peat and vermiculite. A 34-ounce container of Stratolalapsimidis retails for around $40 and can treat between 100 and 200 3-gallon pots, so it's not going to break the bank. Sprinkle it onto the surface of your growing media and you're done. If you can't get a hold of predatory mites, then try a top dressing with diatomaceous earth, growstone gnat mix, or gnat block by Flying Skull. I use Diahydro, which is fairly chunky. Try to get the most powdery stuff at the bottom of the bag. Diatomaceous earth is fine for us to handle, but to a newly born gnat, it's like crawling over a razor wire. It's only really effective when dry, so try not to get it wet. Once again, flooding from the bottom is the preferred method of feeding. Some growers use neem cake in their soil mix or neem seed meal as both a soil enricher and a preventative measure against fungus gnats. If you're growing in NFT grow tanks, then be aware that capillary matting is also a favorite for fungus gnats, so be sure to secure the tank covers well to avoid gaps. Finally, don't forget to secure your air inputs with intake filters or bug screens, and always keep your grow room clean and tidy. If you've been gardening outdoors, take a shower and change your clothes and footwear before entering your indoor garden. Thanks for watching, and don't forget, if you have methods of fungus gnat control or techniques for complete annihilation that I've failed to mention, then please don't forget to share them with us in the comments below. Sometimes battles with fungus gnats can last for months, even years, but don't lose heart, just stay on top of it. Remember to always read the label and take proper precautions when using any pesticide products, especially indoors, my friends. Hit that subscribe button, you know you want to, and it's free and easy. Just like a pair of frisky fungus gnats having a last tango in midair before meeting their inevitable demise. Life is so short, amigos, and on that note, I'll bid you farewell until next time. Adios.